Yes. So starting with today's session on design thinking, let me ask you if you would be able to unmute your mic for a moment and talk, and again mute your mic, okay, so that we'll not have disturbance. What comes to your mind when you think about design thinking? What comes to your mind when you think about design thinking? Can anyone contribute? What comes to your mind when you think about this term design thinking? Now, there are two terms here, design as well as thinking. So what's the first thought comes to your mind, that comes to your mind?
Thinking by way of structure.
Thinking structurally. Okay, good.
Yeah.
Yes, that's true actually. Thinking structurally. Any other thought process? Any other thing that comes to your mind first when you hear these two words, design thinking?
Thinking in a planned way.
Thinking in a planned way. Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Thinking in a planned way. Anybody else would like to contribute? Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead. Yeah. Anybody else would like to contribute? Okay. Fine. So, as ma'am was pointing out, thinking in a planned way or thinking in a structural way. You know, when I ask students, you know, what do you think is design thinking? So most of the time they think it's creative thinking. It's out of the box thinking. Okay. It's thinking about creating something that is totally new, that does not exist at all. But let me tell you, design thinking is actually a thought process. Okay. A thought process that helps us to find last mile user connect. Okay. Now I'm just putting words in front of you, last mile user connect. Now, most of us are from commerce background. We are from teaching business administration in our college and all those things. Maybe you are able to connect with this term called last mile user connect. You know, last mile user connect is nothing but creating a product that a user wants. Okay. Now, what a user wants may not be something that we deliver always. Yeah. What a user wants may not be always something that we deliver. Yeah. So how to find out that solution that exactly fits the need of a user? You know, that is where design thinking, that is what is design thinking. It's a thought process. Okay. It's a very deeply user-centric process. It enhances probability of innovation to happen. It shows path when it's day one. Yeah. So design thinking is a process or is a thought process that when we adopt, we always think user-centric. You know, we always think user-centric. You know, most of the times when we design solution, we think from our perspective. We think this solution may suit him well. And that's how most of our students also take up projects, right? They think this solution may suit them. For example, when they think about creating a solution for a blind man, they think from their perspective. This solution may suit that person who is blind, the person who is visually challenged, the person who is, you know, who's challenged with any other physical disabilities. We think from our perspective, but rarely do we think from their perspective. What if we were blind? Yeah. So that is what is designing. It is deeply user-centric approach by which we cater to the needs of a customer from day one, right? And I'll quickly go through this process. Okay, we'll be discussing a lot of examples because many of us already have gone through this design thinking process through maybe our college or through some entrepreneur development program. So I'll not be going in detail about what is design thinking process, but I'll just briefly tell for people for whom this process may be new. Yeah, if you look at this process, this is the widely accepted process. If you look on internet for references on design thinking, you'll find a lot of references and a lot of steps. Okay, some of them will have just 5 steps, some of will have 6 steps, some of will have different names to these steps. You know, an automobile engineer may have different names to these steps, a food engineer may have a different names to this step, and another innovator, you know, different people have named it, tagged it differently, but nevertheless, this was the first principle that was put forth by Stanford College. And this 5 steps actually encompasses most of our understanding about design thinking. Okay, so let me take you through these steps. Okay, design thinking revolves around these 5 steps. The first step is empathize. Second is define, ideate, then ideate, prototype, and test. Okay, so the first step is empathize. Now, when I say this word empathize, what comes to your mind? What is empathy? if I should ask you, what is empathy? What do you mean by empathy? Yes. What comes to you? What is empathy? How do you define this empathy? Yes. If some of you could unmute and say, what do you think is empathy in your perspective? Yes. What is to empathize? It is to just showing sympathy. Is it all about showing sympathy? What is empathy? Yes, anyone? Anybody would like to contribute? What do you think is empathy? You know? Okay, so is empathy simply about sympathizing? You know, just showing sympathy, you know, if something happens to anyone, we say, you pow. Okay, is that about all about sympathy? Yeah, no. If you look at empathy, the dictionary definition may go thinking from another person's perspective, understanding pain from another person's perspective. Okay, or it may also say stepping into other shoes is a common word that is given for empathy. You know, stepping into other shoes. Yeah, so empathy is a deeply user-centric process. You know, when we think about the pain, not from our perspective, but from their perspective. Okay. For example, the farmers in our country are facing a lot of problem due to drought, due to excessive rain, you know, some places problem due to irregular water supply, problem due to changing climatic conditions, problem due to soil becoming more infertile, so problem due to so many other problems are there. Okay, now farmers are facing so many problems. So what we do mostly is we sit from our couch, from our colleges, our universities, from our comfortable rooms, and we think about their problem and we start writing, making solutions for them. And then when we make the solution, we go to the farmer trying to sell the solution or trying to improve his life. You know? Now that is not what the right way of doing the product development process or creating a solution. You know, empathy is a procedure where you go to the user, where you talk to the user. You understand the pain from his point of view. So if you want to understand the problem of a farmer, maybe you have to spend some time with him. You have to ask him deeply user-centric questions. You have to live with him maybe for a couple of days. And then only you'll be able to understand what is the need of that farmer. What is the problem that he's facing? Yeah. And once you know that problem, now the farmer may list out 10 to 20 problems to you. Right? 10 to 20 problems to you. Now you are not God to solve all his problems. Right? You are not God to solve all his problems. But there is always a possibility of you being able to solve his 3 or 4 problems, or maybe just one problem that's nagging him the most. Now that is where we define the problem. That is where the next step comes, where we define the problem, where we understand his problem and find out the problem that falls under your expertise to solve it. So you constrain it, you validate it, you actually define the problem more clearly that you can approach and solve. Yeah. Then you ideate upon it. Yeah, maybe then you bring that problem to your classroom, you talk to your students or your peers, and you try to find a solution. Maybe through brainstorming, maybe through mind mapping session, maybe through experimental sessions, you try to ideate about how can I solve this problem? How can I solve this problem that this farmer has? And you start ideating. That is where the ideate phase comes, right? And then once you keep on, when you keep on ideating, the next step is about prototyping. You know, once you ideate, you have a solution in hand. Now is the time for you to create a prototype. Now a prototype may be a solution demo, something that you can show and ask a feedback. It can be a minimum viable product, an MVP. Okay, an MVP is nothing but you showcase the product and almost a finished product. You ask the feedback from the customer. At the same time, you ask the customer how much will you pay for it. Yeah, that is an MVP. Or you give them a working prototype to use it, and then you ask them a feedback out. That is what is prototyping stage. And finally is a test stage. A test stage is where you give the product to somebody who is possibly your customer, and you ask them to test it. You ask them to test it. Now when they test it, they may come up with some nuances. They may come up with some nuances which you have to clarify. So once they test it and they are not happy, maybe you have to go back to the prototype stage. Okay. And maybe you have to recreate your prototype. Maybe your product was not having the right finish. Maybe you have to recreate your product from the ideate stage. Maybe you say my idea itself was wrong. So what I want to say is the design thinking process is also an iterative process. It is also an iterative process. Yeah. So when you at the test phase, if you feel you have failed, maybe you have to come back to prototype or ideate, or maybe at a defined stage, and you have to recreate your product, reform your product. Now, design thinking helps us in this iterative process, through this iterative process, to exactly find out the solution that your customers may want. Yeah. Now, what the customers want is having a lot of different meanings. Okay. So, but just a solution to a problem served will not help a customer. A customer may want certain convenience. A customer may want certain comforts. He may want to use a product which does not have a specific friction. Now, that is what design thinking process does. You know, design thinking process, without design thinking process also, a person can develop a product. But the problem is, only after the product reaches the market, he will know the feedback, and maybe he'll fail and he has to bear a big cost. So that's the problem. When we do not use design thinking process, we cancel off an innovative thought process, and then we create a product which may serve as a solution, but may not serve with the solution may not be convenient to use. The solution may not be apt solution that will be comfortable to be used by your customer. So that is what is design thinking process. Let's go ahead with some examples, especially as our topic today is how to use design thinking principle in the post-COVID-19 era, right? So let's talk a bit about COVID-19 era. Now, we know this is one of the greatest catastrophe that has come over our entire nation and the world. You know, everywhere there is lockdown all over the world. India had imposed one of the strictest lockdown. People cannot go out in public without wearing mask. You know, people cannot trust even their neighbors today. In populated areas like Mumbai, Delhi, they don't know who's carrying the virus, from who's the carrier of coronavirus. You know, there is a situation of uncertainty everywhere. Businesses are closed. People are anxious about losing their jobs, or even if people are having their jobs, their pays are cut. You know, people like us, universities, are very anxious. How will we accommodate students when they come back? You know, how are the admissions going to be? You know, there was one of the largest migrant crises the world has seen happen in India, when a lot of migrant laborers from states like Delhi and Maharashtra and Kolkata and all started going back to their own towns in Bihar and UP and Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh. There was a lot of migrants moving, and because there was a stringent lockdown in place, these migrants could not find any transport, and what they were doing was they were walking for hundreds of kilometers, as you can see in pictures, maybe some of them with their children, small children, okay, and with their loads and everything. So it's a very pity situation. We see hospitals that are overcrowded everywhere. You know, we see the same shopping malls we enjoyed hanging out every weekend are now closed. They do not allow more than 5 people inside even a supermarket. You know, all these inconveniences that are caused due to one single pandemic that has hit our world, and it has hit very hard. The world is never going to be the same. The world is never going to be the same. Our education systems are never going to be the same. Our institutional structures are never going to be the same. You know, the workforce in factories are never going to behave the same. There is going to be massive reformations that are going to happen from today, you know, from this era, from post-COVID-19 era. So how do we prepare ourselves, you know, and to prepare ourselves for innovation in this post-COVID-19 era, you know, there is one tool that I would recommend all of you to use and recommend to your students to use, is design thinking. So design thinking is a tool by which actually we can come across solutions that the customer wants in the post-COVID-19 era. Yeah. So just think about the post-COVID-19 era. Okay, our times. How will that be? Imagine about your colleges or your universities. How will they have to behave? Some of you have benches. Would you be able to seat 2 students in the same bench now? Will the government allow it? You may have water doctors in your college. Will you be able to use a water doctor in the same way? Will the canteens be able to be functioned in the same way? Yeah. Where, you know, there are so many places, so many distractions that are going to happen at our university, at college level itself, right? When how much the parents will trust to send their students to distant places, to distant universities, colleges, you know. So a lot of massive transformation. Now, we all never met on a webinar like this, right? Most of the times we were called in person, we came to your college, we talked to the faculties directly, students directly, but now that has become a distant dream, right? Most of us are bound to our houses, our rooms, and we are talking online through these platforms like Google Meet and Zoom and other platforms. These were all present even maybe 2 or 3 years back, but we never found a requirement for you. So our educational propagation has changed. The way we propagate education has changed. You know, there is going to be a massive transformation in every industry in the days to come. And to be prepared for this massive transformation that is going to happen and to capitalize on the opportunities it throws, we need to be ready with some tool. And one tool I would recommend you is have design thinking as a tool. And I would highly recommend you to educate your students, your peers about using this tool to create solutions for the future. Now, let me tell you, design thinking is not a tool to be used only by entrepreneurs. It is a tool that can be used by teachers. It can be used by homemakers. It can be used by people in a factory, in an industry who's running a small store in the street. Maybe it can be used even by students who are studying in a college. Anybody can use it. It is just a thought process. It is a thought process that helps us to understand the needs of others in the right way. Yeah. So post COVID-19 times, you know, let me ask you, what is that one innovation that comes to your mind when you think about post COVID-19 times? What is that one thing that most of us would be using? Yes.
Sir, excuse me.
Yeah.
So the screen, there's a blank in the screen. There's a presentation.
There's a blank in the screen.
Yeah, presentation.
Yeah, yeah, that's a blank. That the picture will come later only, sir.
Okay. Sorry, thank you.
This post COVID-19 times is visible, no, sir? Hello?
Yes, sir.
That
yes,
is visible,
sir.
No, sir? Yeah. So, my question is to faculty. So what is that one thing that comes to your mind will become normal in the days to come? That one innovation or one product that most of us would be using post COVID-19. Yes, anybody thinks about something that, you know, will become normal, you know, when you go out, come in. Yes, I believe this is going to become very normal, right? Yeah. So if you look at the present time itself, you know, government has issued advisory that none of us should go out without wearing a face mask, right? None of us should go out without wearing a face mask. Now, this is not a option, it has become mandatory. So if we violate it, government can make us even punish us until this at least COVID-19 subsides, right? So people have become now masked, right? So we never thought about using mask only we thought maybe medical professionals have to use it, or people who are working in sanitation and all those have to use it. We never thought mask is going to become a kind of lifestyle choice, right, where people everywhere are going to use mask. Okay, as you can see, maybe our future classrooms will look something like this. Okay, all our students wearing masks, and maybe even faculty is wearing masks. Now, you may be going out for shopping. Now, you cannot but wear mask, right? So, mask has become kind of a trend now. And yes, it has been advised by the government very strictly and enforced in many places to wear mask, right? So, mask is one protective layer that is protecting us from these droplets that can be carried over from the infected patients, and we can infect us, others. So mask has become something important. Now, mask is not the only innovation that is going to be there, but I'm just taking an example of mask for this post COVID-19 times, right? So, what do you think in India is going to be the mask wearing culture? Yeah. So if you look at the pain points of wearing this same mask, okay, if you look at the pain points of wearing this mask, you see there is a gap. If you look at the surgical mask, there is this gap at the sides, which actually is not that good, right? Maybe it can actually still create some problem by allowing some droplets to enter. Now, when you look at the pain points of wearing a mask are not available in all sizes always. And only now people are actually thinking about smaller mask, bigger mask. Now, if you see, if your child has to wear a mask that you wear, it will become too big for him, right? It may even cover his entire face. Yeah. And long term, long time using of mask. We saw some doctors who are using mask for 8 hours or 9 hours a day. Their faces look something like this. And not only one day, but every day. People were using every day. Their faces had this rashes. Their faces had this deep cuts and all formed by mask. This is the reality. This is the reality that can happen if you wear mask for a long time. Maybe we wear mask for just a couple of minutes when you go out or hours. But if somebody is wearing it for 12 hours to 15 hours, sometimes even 18 hours a day, where all these health workers were stretched beyond working hours to work towards saving many patients, they were having this trouble wearing the mask, you know. So these are some of the pain points of wearing this mask. You know, mask is the mandate now. Everyone should wear a mask, but mask does not come without wearing pain points. So you see, so when the coronavirus hit the world and people knew that one way to protect yourself is through by maintaining social distancing and by wearing a mask. So everywhere this mask became a trend and everyone started wearing a mask. But when you started wearing mask, you started finding inconveniences, right? You started finding that it was not very convenient behind your ear. The elastic used to hurt your ear. Sometimes when you talk using a mask, your spit or the saliva sometimes gets stuck to the mask and it becomes wet and it becomes very discomfortable after that. You know, you saw this surgical mask, you could wear it for a day, but next day you could not wear it. You have to use and throw it. Even even there was mask not possible to have in all sizes. You know, even wearing some mask did not make you feel comfortable, did not make you feel protected. You know, then there came an era where there were different types of masks with different types of protection and this and that. You know? So mask, though mask is a solution to protect yourself, protect us from this coronavirus, from this coronavirus, but still it is not something that is convenient. It is coming with a lot of pain points, right? So thinking about mask culture in India, you know, maybe our future classrooms may look like this. Okay, when the classes are restarting, you know, you see teachers wearing a mask, you see students wearing a mask in their class, maybe children going to school wearing a mask, children sitting in the school wearing a mask. Now you may see, have the schools open in India? You know, we didn't know. We thought the government has advised to not open the schools in India till September. Let me tell you, schools have not opened in India, but mask culture is not new to India, right? Schools have not opened in India, but mask culture is not new to India. You may think mask culture has just come now, but let me tell you, mask culture may be new to places like Coimbatore, Chennai, Tamil Nadu, states like Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and maybe most of the states in India. But let me tell you, mask culture is very popular in one state in our India, that is New Delhi, right? New Delhi, as most of you know, is one of the worst polluted cities in the world. The worst polluted city in the world. The pollution levels there in the month of from November to January, especially during those cold season, is at one of the highest level, where PM 2.5 content in the air, particulate matter 2.5 content in the air is so high, it goes beyond sometimes 5 times the danger level proposed by the World Health Organization. You know, it is so harmful. The air there is so polluted that people, if they breathe that air, they can get critical lung disorders. There's also some studies, unverified studies, of course, which says the life term of people in Delhi is reduced to 7 years because of the hazardous air that they breathe. You know, so the pollution is so high in Delhi that government in Delhi puts an advisory in every year during this cold season between November to January that everyone should wear masks. So teachers wear masks, employees wear their masks, students wear masks over there. So mask is not something new in Delhi. Mask is kind of already a culture in Delhi where people are already wearing masks, right? But there, of course, the purpose of wearing the mask there was protecting one from pollution. Now, think about this, you know. Think about this. How comfortable you'll be wearing mask for 3 to 4 months together. Think about if your child is going to wear this mask for 8 hours in a school. Think about this situation where you are asked to wear a mask for 10 hours a day in your workplace. How will you feel comfortable? It will be very discomfortable. Especially if you are in a place like Delhi, one of the most polluted cities, you have no other option but to wear it. Otherwise, you'll be exposed to one of the most hazardous situations, right? So how do you make it convenient? You know, that is where I found a solution that is brought by a student actually, okay, by using this very design thinking solution, where he has come up with one product called nasofilters. I don't know how many of you have heard about it. It's called nasofilters. Nasofilter is actually a filter that can get stuck to your nose orifice. As you can see here, it can get stuck to your nose orifice. So it helps you to breathe through your nose orifice. And because this gets stuck here under your nose, nobody will be even able to notice it that easily. Yeah. So rather than using a mask, they have this simple filter. This filter is PM 2.5 resistant filter. So it actually resists PM 2.5 particles to enter your nose. Yeah. So, and it is not visible at all. So isn't this more convenient to use something like this rather than wearing an entire mask? Yeah. Now this is an example of design thinking. Yeah. So I would like to show you one video just for an example of how this solution has worked out. Okay, let me just play that video.
Nasofilters is a patch which sticks onto your nasal orifice, doesn't go inside your nose and doesn't cover your face either, and at the same time restricts all the pollutants and the smallest of the bacterias entering into your body. You can speak while putting it on, you can even eat while it's on your nose. We have used a unique technology which we call as nanotechnology. We are making nanofibers which are 100 times smaller than a thread of a normal fabric, and we are also increasing the pore density of a normal fabric by millions of times on a unit area. This is the technology that we have built, that we have produced to make filter media of nasofilters, which is giving us really high efficiencies to restrict PM 2.5, the most penetrating particles, and smallest of the bacteria. The idea actually originated to solve a personal problem, to solve my mother's problem rather. She is an asthmatic, came into my mind to get some product to save, to relieve my mother's problem in the initial days. And then I came to know that this is a problem of billion other Indians and all across the globe. We are a team of highly expert technocrats, IIT Delhi graduates and IIT Delhi professors from textile departments, and together we have built the design and the technology of nasofilters. We are getting responses from queries from schools, school staffs as well, employees, companies, industries, hospitals rather. And
yes, so was that an amazing innovation? Yeah, so if you look at the innovation, nasofilters, it's very simple. And if you see, the person he empathized with is his own mother, right? With his own mother. His mother is an asthmatic, and she found she has breathing trouble, but she is not a person who likes to wear mask, right? And let me ask you a question. How many of you are comfortable wearing mask, and how many of you think you have to you'll be comfortable wearing mask if you're asked to do so for an entire year, every day in the college? Now you may say, maybe one hour after two or three days, I'll get used to it. Yeah. But still, it is not a convenient affair, right? And it does have a lot of side effects. It has a lot of pain points. Now this is where he came up, this chap comes up with this wonderful innovation called nasofilter, you know, or something that sticks to your nose, you know. Now that is what is called as design thinking. The same, there is a problem of pollution, and the people go for a, there is a problem called pollution, and the immediate solution that comes to your mind is use a face mask, right? Use a face mask. But nobody talks about the pain points of having a face mask, right? Nobody talks about the pain point of having a face mask. Now this is where an innovation using design thinking comes into play, where if you empathize with the people, if you ask their inconveniences, you can come across solution that can fit their requirement. Now remember, if you give them to wear a face mask, they will wear, but they will wear with a lot of inconvenience. Yeah? But if you give them a solution, something like nasofilter, which gets stuck to your nasal orifice, and is not even visible for that it's not even visible and can last up to 8 to 10 hours under your nose, you know, not making you breathe clean air. Now that is a solution that you require, which serves a purpose as well as is convenient to use. That is what users will mostly buy. That is what is called as design thinking process. You know, when you apply design thinking, your solutions will become more user-centric. Are you able to understand your solutions become more user-centric? You know, if you ask anybody without using the design thinking process, they may come immediately with a solution. That is a solution to the problem. Yes, mask is a solution to the problem, but it's not a convenient solution. Yeah, that is what is design thinking. Let me give you a few more examples in the present area. Of course, nasal filters is not a solution for combating a pandemic like coronavirus, and we require a mask because we are not resisting PM2.5 particle. We are resisting droplets that go through air, right? Now, droplets that pass through air, which can get into our mouth, our nose, even sometimes our eyes, and which can infect us. So the purpose of protection over here is a little different with respect to virus. But we are also seeing a lot of innovation coming in the present time. Let me show you a few innovations. If you see the innovations in mask, you would be finding mask in various designs and shapes and colors. You know, some of the mask that comes with the purpose of protecting the frontline workers. For example, our health workers who are working in the front line, who are standing in the borders, screening vehicles in and out, and testing patients who are suspect of coronavirus. They all require maybe N95. Mask which has a very high protective layer with a nose clip which will not allow any droplets to pass through their mouth. If they require some high end protective layer, but others like us who maintain social distancing, we just want a mask which will not allow any accidental droplets to enter our mouth. So, but still people like to be more trendy, right? You ask your students to wear a blue surgical mask, they will not find it convenient. So you see a lot of trendy, fashionable masks that are coming into the market now, right? With different colors, designs, shapes, and sizes, you know. So this has also become a trend of the time, different types of masks. This is also part of design thinking. So, you know, what do people want? Now, another example I would give you is a mask that was used in, made in Kerala by one photo studio. Okay, he came across this idea of why not I print the mask. Print the face of a person on the mask and give to the person, right? So when the person wears the mask, the person is not aloof. It's not like you cannot recognize the person. Still the person can be recognizable. The person has a personality visible on his face, even with a mask, right? So he came out with this solution. It was a simple solution. The same photo studio he used to print pictures, he started printing their photos on a mask and selling it. And let me tell you, there is a big demand for this mask from his shop from that day when he started this solution, right? So there is another solutions coming all over the world. If you look at Israel, they have come out with this solution of mask that you can see on your left, which is a mask that is self-cleaning. So this mask has a heating element that surrounds the layer. So when you plug it to the charger, as you can see, the mask after using it, for example, if you've gone to work and returned back, and if you want to clean your mask rather than dipping in water and cleaning it, what you can do is you can just plug into plug into power, and it will heat the element filament all over the mask, which will actually kill all the germs and virus and bacteria and all those things. It's a easily cleanable mask, right? And it also has a top which you can open to drink water, okay? So a different design thinking solution, maybe useful for people who have to wear masks for longer amount of time, especially in hospitals and all, and who cannot use and throw masks that often, right? And then there is another solution of come, as you can see to the right, is masks with antiviral material, right? So if even some droplets of virus and all falls on this mask, it will be immediately dissipated. So mask with antiviral layers also was something that some startups in Israel came across with solution. Israel is a country which is known for most innovative startups in the world, and they have come up with really innovative solutions with respect to mask in this pandemic times. You know, one of my some of you would have noticed this in the television that people are coming out with trendy masks for the coming Onam season. Okay, some of you may recognize that in Onam time they have a sari, or men wear a munda with this design and color. So they're coming with matching mask for the Onam season. Now already in the market we see that there are designer masks available for matching your shirts or your saris or your, any of your tops. So mask is becoming more trendier. Now one of my student Mr. Vishwas, he has come up with a mask which will ensure social distancing. He says he want to create this mask with as you can see there is a sensor in front of its mouth, in front of the mask, which will ensure that nobody takes their hand towards their face or nose. So if you are taking your hand towards your face or nose, an alarm will beep, alarming you or alerting you that you are taking your hand towards your face or nose to scratch, as well as the, as well as whenever somebody approaches you within 1 feet, 2 feet of a distance, it also alerts you, right, that somebody is approaching you too close. Maybe you have to maintain social distancing. So this is also a solution you have done by design thinking for a specific audience. You know, there are also solutions that one student in the University of Kentucky has come across with. Now she has created a transparent mask. Now you may ask, why a transparent mask? Well, she has made this mask for the people who are deaf and mute, or who are who cannot speak or hear. Now you know most of the people are not 100% deaf. Okay, they are partially deaf, and most of the people nowadays do not communicate by sign language, but they actually do lip reading, right? So if you have conversed with somebody who is deaf and mute, you would have found out that they read your lips more efficiently, right? They read your lips more effectively. So if they face you and talk with you, if you face them and talk with them, they understand you better. So lip reading is very important for them. So she has actually made a mask for people who are actually deaf and mute. Yeah. So that they can actually, when they talk to each other, they can actually understand by lip reading. Yeah. So she has come across this solution. Yeah. So you see so many different approaches towards creating masks, and the solutions will keep on going. Okay. Will keep on going. Now, what I want to stress here is, you see, there's one problem that is the spreading of this virus, and there is one solution, that is this mask. Yeah? And people are coming up with so many innovative ways. Now, how are they doing it? When they're empathizing with somebody, right? When they're empathizing with somebody. Yeah. Now, somebody empathizes with a frontline health worker. Okay, what is their requirement? What kind of mask can they wear, and will they be comfortable? Somebody is empathizing with maybe deaf and mute people. Somebody is empathizing with maybe a person from an IT industry, finding out their intricate requirements. You know, so people are empathizing with different group of people and coming up with solution that will suit them or that will serve their purpose. Now that is exactly what is design thinking. You know, so do you think at creating a solution from that perspective? Yeah. Otherwise, if we do not have this design thinking principle in place, then we will all be wearing only surgical masks. Okay. Nobody will think about innovation and creating the mask more trendier. You know, maybe mask that suits your shirt or your saris or your tops. You know, people are thinking, when the people think from the customer's perspective is when actually the real innovation happens. Yeah. Innovation is not something that looks good, feels good. No. Innovation is about what the customer wants. If you deliver something that the customer wants, that is what is innovation. And it need not be rocket science. All these innovations that you find are not rocket science. They are simple innovations created to suit the customer's need. That is what design thinking does. Yeah. So let me give another example. Of course, this is with respect to post-COVID-19 times, this thing. Let me give another example, which is of this case, right? You may be knowing this entrepreneur called Mr. PC Mustafa and his startup called ID Fresh Food. Yeah? Most of you would have heard about a startup called ID Fresh Food. Now, I want to talk about a startup, because a startup or a business need not use design thinking only in the beginning stage of their startup. They can also use it at any other stage. Even if they are already in the market for 5 years, 10 years, they can use it. Even if they're a business which is 100 years old, they can use it. Design thinking is not a process which an entrepreneur has to use to start building his product. No. Even to refine his product, to optimize his solution or his services or even his marketing strategy, people can use design thinking. So I want to give you two case studies from PC Mustafa's life, how he has designed his product, designed his offerings using design thinking, not only his product and services, but also his marketing. In his marketing strategy, he has used a design thinking process. So let me give you an example. Now, to give a background about PC Mustafa, he has this ID Fresh Food Industry, which makes idli dosa batter. Most of you would have noticed it in your, if you would have gone to supermarkets and all, you would have definitely seen it. It is not something new. Pretty popular brand in Tamil Nadu and Kerala now. So they provide this idli dosa batter, and what they claim is they do not use any preservatives or any artificial flavors or chemicals to preserve their food. So that is their claim. So their food has, their idli dosa batter have lower shelf life, but can be actually used with 100% trust because it does not have any additives, okay, or any artificial flavors or preservatives added with it. Yeah, so they claim this particular thing, and that's why this startup has become immensely popular. Now, if you, one innovative product that they have released, which I will like to show you, is this vada batter, right? They also sell this vada batter. Now, we all have seen idli dosa batter being sold in that plastic bags, right? Most of us would have also bought it, maybe buying it often from the shops, this idli dosa batter that we get. And what about making vada batter, right? What about making medu vada batter? Now, if you can see the design of this medu vada batter, this is made for a specific purpose. Now, all of us know that we judge the quality of vada first by its look, right? Even if you go to Ananda's, Annapurna's or any popular vegetarian restaurant, you judge the quality of the vada that is offered to you by its look, right? Is it perfect circle, okay? Is it crispy? Is it perfectly, you know, and does it have a perfect hole in between? If it does not have a perfect hole in between, you will say this is not made by someone who's professional at it. You know? So, you know, this is, though vada is something that every one of us would like to make it and eat it, but we do not make it because sometimes we do not get that perfect circle. You know, this is something that he understood by empathizing with people and modern housewives, I should say. They were not making vada just because of the fear that they had was they will not be able to make vada with the perfect circle. Some of you may have your mother-in-laws or maybe your mother who may not be pleased by you making a vada, maybe because you do not come up with the perfect circle. Maybe some of you may have people at your home who will not be pleased if you make a vada without a hole in it. Now, this is a very simple problem, but he thought about solving this problem. And that actually led him to create this vada batter making machine, which actually helps you to make a perfect vada. Let me show you that video.
This is no ordinary snack, a South Indian specialty. It's a favorite in homes across India, but its circular cylindrical shape and donut-like hole make it fairly difficult to prepare at homes. It needs the expert hands of grandmas and aunts or even restaurant cooks. Not anymore. ID decided to turn its attention on this age-old problem and transform the complex art of vada making into a science for everyone. And the key ingredient? Common sense. A path-breaking little big invention. The spout that shapes batter into vadas with the hole. And that's it. Squeeze, shape, cut, fry. Handmade, but with no mess, no stress. Just delicious, crispy vadas. ID, maker of India's favorite batters and fresh food, presents Vada Batter in a pack that shapes batter into vadas. Now, everybody can vada.
So, how many of you found this interesting? So, if you see at him, he has taken a simple problem that every household may face in the modern times, right? Of creating vadas that look good, maybe taste good, you know. So, did you think design thinking could be, used to a simple household problem like making vada? Definitely it can be used. That's why I said design thinking is not something that can be used only by, you know, entrepreneurs or, you know, engineers. It can be used by anyone. It can be used by homemakers, anyone. And this is a solution that ID Fresh Food came. And after this, their idli vada, this vada batter became immensely popular. You know, so many people started buying this. It became one of their most popular product just because of one principle called design thinking. There are many other people who are offering vada batter, but, you know, they did not sell as much as they sell now because of this patented technology that they have created. It's a simple common sense patented technology, you know, which makes you make vada, which looks good, you know, which tastes good, you know, which looks good with the perfect hole and the right cylindrical shape. Now, this is what is called as design thinking. This is what is called as design thinking. Okay. Now, coming back to, let me take you back to the presentation. Yeah, just a minute. Yes. So that is how design thinking can be used. Now, to the right hand side, if you see this fridge, yeah, I believe my PPT is visible to all of you. John, PPT is visible up again. Yeah, okay. So if you see the right hand side, at there is a fridge that I have kept, that I am showing, right? Now, if you see this ID Trust and Shop. Now, there is one more threat this ID Fresh Food was facing was marketing their product. You know, they were a startup and they did not have a lot of capital to spend to market their product at a scale that others could do. That is where he thought about putting some innovation in marketing. And he found that many people will not buy an idli vada batter because of one major issue. They think it is added with a lot of soda. They think it is added with preservatives. Even if we claim that it is preservative free, soda free and all, people will not. Now, this is a mindset of people. So people did not trust him. And he understood that unless somebody trusts you, they will not do business with you. So when he asked many housewives, this was one issue. They said, we just don't trust you. So he wanted to make a system by which he'll put the trust to them. You know, he'll put the trust to them. So by just playing with the trust factor of an individual, will they be able to buy their product more? So this was an issue. This was actually a testing he wanted to. So he came up with innovative solution, as you can see at the right, a fridge. Okay, he went and installed this fridge in 40 different apartments, in the most crowded apartments in a place. And when he placed this fridges in those apartments, he kept all these products that the ID Fresh Food would make, this idli batter, vada batter, dosa batter, and all those batters. Yeah, he kept it in those fridge. Okay, and also he kept a system by which they can pay for it. Yeah, and let me tell you, he had this fridge which was not seen by anyone. You know, there was no camera monitoring it. There was no salesperson monitoring it. You know, there was no technology that was included in it to see if somebody took a vada batter and did not pay for it. Nothing. It was totally a trust-based shop. Yeah. So what they proclaimed that we trust the people to pay. Okay. And we are not going to monitor them. Yeah. We are not going to monitor them. So this actually worked. In fact, when they kept this fridge in apartments with all this idli vada batter, you know, many people said they are fools. You know, who people will just walk in with a vada batter and will never pay for it. But to his amazement, more than 99% of the people paid for it. You know, hardly there was anything that was taken from the fridge without paying for it. And it was very convenient for people in the apartment. Just to walk down the apartment, take the vada batter they want or idli batter they want and go and cook it. Pay for it then and there itself. You know, other thing that they noticed was they got a trust for this ID Fresh Food. They said, is there a brand who can trust us so much in this present times when people can steal and do fraud and all this thing? But they said, if somebody trusts us so much, you know, shouldn't we trust them? You know, it was a give and take. If you trust somebody, they will definitely trust you. So ID Fresh Food showed the way of trusting their customers by placing a unmanned, unmonitored, no cameras, no monitoring, no salesperson based kiosk through a fridge. They started selling their products, and this was awarded in 2015 as the best marketing practice in India. So this is how a person can come up with innovative marketing techniques also when they use this technical design thing, when they empathize with their customer. What led to this innovation was this empathizing with the customer. When he empathized deeply, they found that the reason they did not buy is not because of convenience. The reason they did not buy is because of the trust. is this good? Is this product not laced with chemicals and preservatives and all? How can I trust it? So that is where, rather than convincing them through costly advertisements of trust my product that it is good, he actually went to sell this product in a different way. So that is where you can actually use design thinking in marketing. Maybe you can market a course in your university using design thinking process. You know, it can be used in any place. Yeah? And in post-COVID-19 era, this becomes much more relevant for us. This becomes much more relevant for us to come up with innovative solutions. Yes. So that is what is design thinking. It can be used in so many different places. Yes. So I'll just close with this one case study. Okay. I'll just close with this one case study, which is very student centric, because most of you are teachers here, I understand. It may help you to even nurture your students. Now, this case study is what happens in Professor Dargalkar. He's from Velankar Institute of Management in Mumbai. Now, he has a design thinking exercise that he takes every year. Okay, he takes a design thinking exercise every year for his class. And one exercise he takes is, why not you, he makes students into groups in his class, in his MBA class. And he asks each group to go and empathize for 2 weeks with a target audience. Yeah. So he gives a target audience for each group. For example, one group he will tell go and empathize with people who are sanitation workers. Another group he'll say go and empathize with people who are working grocery stores. So he'll give a target audience to each group. And one group that he gave a target audience was, he asked one group of students to go and empathize with a deaf and mute housewife. Now, when he said to go and empathize with the deaf and mute housewife, this group was taken up. He said, where will you find out? He said, go find out. And through a lot of struggle, to cut the story short, they found out finally through their relatives and relatives' relatives that there was one person, one lady who was deaf and mute, who was a housewife. Yeah, deaf and mute housewife. Now, the professor said, good, if you have found that person, please go and empathize. So what the students did, they immediately went, found an audience with that woman, and through her husband, they asked a few questions. They asked, is your life comfortable? Do you have some problems that we can solve? And with a very gleaming smile, she said she has no problems. You know, who will tell you about their problems, right? They will ask you, what is your problem, if you go and ask them. So they were not very comfortable. She was not very comfortable talking about her problem. She said, I have no problem. You know, I am happy. I am fine. But this actually intrigued the students. They came back immediately to the professor. They said, she has no problem. She is happy. The professor said, no. Did you empathize? So the professor told them that empathy is not about asking some written questions. It's not running a survey sheet. Let me tell you, empathy is not about running a survey. It's living with the person, understanding his perspective. This is the same words that the professor told to his students. And the students went back to the person, got the permission from the husband of that woman. Can we spend some quality time with her between 9 to 5 when the husband goes to work and when she is alone at home? And after getting the permission of the husband, these three students, they actually started spending some time with the housewife during the daytime. So they just wanted to observe what she was doing. So one thing they observed during the daytime is, this woman had a habit, even if she's working in a kitchen or anywhere in the house, every 5 minutes, she would come and look at the door. She'll come and look at the house door. And there was an opening at the left side of the door. She'll always come and have a look there and go back. Now, the one reason they found out she was doing this is because she could not hear the bell sound. If somebody was knocking the door or ringing the bell, she could not hear it. So she wanted to just check if anybody has come. Has a milkman come? Has a vegetable vendor? She used to keep on looking at that. Now, other problem they figured out was, when she used to keep something in cooker, yeah, when she was cooking, she will never move from there. She'll keep on looking at the cooker. The reason is, if you and I, if we cook in our kitchen using a cooker, we know, we take a audible reference, right? We take oral reference, right? When the cooker whistle goes up, hearing the sound, we know that 3 whistles have gone or 4 whistles have gone and the cooking is over. But this is not possible for her. She was not able to find out if the cooking is over, because she could not hear the sound of the whistle. She had to only see it when the whistle goes up and down. So she did not move from the front of the cooker when the cooker was kept. There was a microwave oven which had finished the job, but still she did not observe the beep because she was deaf and mute. Now, these were some problems which are totally hidden from the students until they lived with her for a week. Now, when they saw this, they understood that this can, we can make a solution for it, right? Now, when the woman put the clothes in the washing machine, she looked at it, she calculated time for it and all those things. She could not hear the beep or the alarm that the washing machine gave. Now, all these were simple livelihood problems that she had on daily basis. But she did not think it as a problem. She was solving it her own tedious way or inconvenient way. That is where the students said, why not make a solution for it? To cut the story short, the students went back and had a lot of brainstorming session and came up with a solution. As you can see, a wearable device which has different color LEDs. So, and it vibrates also, and it vibrates also. So whenever the person talked or whenever there was a doorbell that was rung, a particular LED will glow with a vibration that goes to the hand. When the whistle in the cooker is to go on, another LED will glow with a vibration to the hand. So this solution actually suited them and actually solved her problem. So that is exactly what design thinking does. Yeah. So design thinking helps us to look at the customers from their perspective. Now, if you look at the solution over here, you may say this was an excellent solution by the students, and they actually came out with a solution that suits the housewife, but they never pursued it. The reason was, back in 2009-10, when they came up with the solution, the problem that was there was this solution did not have the manufacturing process required around 19 different licenses, and this 19 different licenses required around close to a year time. And that actually made the process very trivial for these students, and they did not pursue this solution as it is. They understood the technical feasibility. Finally, they started collaborating with a company who was making wearable devices, and started selling softwares to them, and they started licensing their technology to them. So you see, though they came up with a product, they did not make a product. They actually collaborated and finally ended up selling a software rather than the solution itself. So that is how design thinking actually works. Design thinking not only solves the problem of the person, but also finds the right medium by which the solution can be taken to the market. So that is what is called as design thinking. Yeah. So in short, if I should say, design thinking encompasses these three areas. You know, it encompasses the user needs, the technical possibilities, and the business goals, right? So the user need, technical possibilities, and business goals, when you put all these things together, there is a sweet spot that we need to find out where we have to offer our solution. So maybe your solution is perfect for the audience, but is the solution convenient? Find out. Okay. And even when you find the solution convenient, is it the way that you can take it to the market? You have to find that also. Okay. So that is what is design thinking. It actually helps you to find out what are the user needs, what are the technical possibilities, what are the business goals, and find a sweet spot by which you can offer the right product to the right customer in the through the right channel. Yeah. That is what is design thinking. Yes. So I'll keep the floor open, John sir, for maybe another 5 minutes for any questions that the audience may have.
Audience, if you have any doubt, you can clarify now, or otherwise you can put it in your chat box.
Okay, one question by Suresh Kumar. What about expiry date of vada batter? If product is sell before expiry date, it will lose loss only, sir. Ideas? Yeah. Definitely it will be a loss. Okay. And one way that they overcome this issue is they do go for a 70-30 principle, I've heard, where they always remember that 70% of the products only will be sold, 30% may not be sold. So in that way, they make up for the cost of these unsold product also from the product that is sold. Yeah. So this is one technique that is used. Design thinking is applied for old and new product. As I said, design thinking can be used for any process. Ms. Princy has asked, design thinking is applied for old and new products. Sir. So I don't know if that is a question. If that's a question, I would say yes, design thinking can be used for old as well as new products. It need not be used only for product. It can be used in the way the product is marketed or taken to the market also. Yeah. So one example you can find on internet is if you know Burger King, they came up with a solution of taking the product burger to the market in Mexico by capitalizing on the traffic problem. So they had they created an app called Traffic Whopper. Now Burger King is from many years in Mexico, but when they found that there's a problem that 3 to 4 hours people are stuck in the traffic, they thought about creating an app which will deliver the burger to a person who's stuck in the traffic into their car. So the app became immensely popular. Their sales revenue became started increasing by 63% immediately after that app was released. Yeah. So at any stage of the product, at any stage of the business or a startup, design thinking as a principle can be used. Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you for your very informative session.
Thank you, sir.
With a part of I think design thinking can be applied. Eventually, we'll be doing in our colleges with the students and inculcating it to develop the entrepreneurship. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Now I hand over this session to Manjula Devi for a word of thanks.
Good morning to all. It's my great privilege to render a word of thanks. First of all, I would like to thank our SNME management, our principal, head of the department, and staff of BCom Banking and Insurance organized this faculty development program. And also, I would like to submit our gratitude to our resource person, Mr. N. Vishal Vijay, assistant professor from Coronia University, having delivered in an enlightened message and on design thinking for entrepreneurial development. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
I would like to thank each and every participant for your valuable participation to making this program as a great program. Thank you all. Once again, thank you all.
Thank you so much, all of you. Thank you, John, sir. Thank you for the management of SNMB for having me.
Yes, sir. Have a nice day. You're welcome very much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.